Hello, welcome to this webinar from Toradex. Today we are going to talk about containers. As you can see here, the title is Why Containers Aren't Just for Hipsters. So we are going to talk a bit about modern software development and how this can also apply to embedded devices. I am Walter Minute, I'm a software engineer. I am with Toradex since 7 years, but of course I'm not the subject of the webinar, luckily. So I will just move forward to the more interesting content. Before moving to the topic, a few words about Toradex. Maybe many of you already know our company. We are a relatively small company, but we have a worldwide presence. As you can see here from the map, we are office in Switzerland, in Lucerne, where I'm currently based, but also in the US. We have an office in Seattle, also one person on the East Coast, in Brazil, India, China, Japan, and Vietnam. So we try to cover the whole world with people speaking the different languages and living and working in the different time zones. Our mission, let's say, is to make embedded computing easy. So we make system of modules based on ARM CPUs, and we try to make them easy to use. This is our product portfolio. We have three family of products, Apalis and Colibri, that are the, let's say, long-standing families of our modules. All the modules are pin-to-pin compatible in the family. And also we have Verdin, that is our brand new family. So as you can see, we have a broad range of SoCs, some from NVIDIA, some from NXP, ranging from low power and low cost one like Colibri IMX6 ULL or IMX7, up to very performance CPUs, like IMX8, Quad Max, and TK1 from NVIDIA. So you can probably find something that can fit your requirements, as already many customers did. We have many customers, thousands of customers in different markets, in industrial automation, in healthcare and medical devices, transportation, and a lot of other different markets. We usually target what are small and medium customers for, let's say, our competitors. We care about companies making hundreds and thousands of devices, up to 50,000 devices. That is usually the maximum range where it's economically convenient to use a system or model. Before talking about containers, let's do a step back and talk about software development in general. I found this funny picture on the internet, and you know, it's showing my code and on top of a very precarious stack of cans, and each one is one of the source of knowledge for modern software developers, ranging from YouTube, GitHub, and so on. As any funny joke, I think there is some truth behind it. And here the point is basically that software development is becoming more and more complex. We have better and better tools, but what we are asked to do, it's more and more complicated. And that's true also for embedded devices. If we talk about devices, if we look at the SoCs we are using, they are getting more and more complex. They provide many features. Every new generation is providing new features, but managing all these kind of features, it's getting more and more complicated. You have multimedia, you have connectivity, and a lot of other things. And when we develop software, let's say modern software, also the range of skills we need to have, it's really broad. It can be skills for an individual developer, it may be skills distributed across a development team, but we probably need to understand the low-level parts. We still have to deal with the hardware, so low-level protocols or how to work with drivers and so on, but also high-level topics like connectivity. We need to share data, to exchange data with cloud-based services, for example, or we need to implement the modern UI that is fancy and reactive and so on. And all those requirements are piling up over time when we move forward with the technology. But on the other side, we still have, let's say, all the traditional requirements from the embedded industry. That is that our system needs to be very reliable. Many embedded devices are really critical parts of some kind of infrastructure, and you don't want to have them failing for just a software bug or something like this. And dealing with complexity, we also need to stay productive. And productivity for embedded devices may mean that we should be able to quickly build a proof of concept or a prototype, because maybe our device is not there, it's not even sure that we are going to build it. And so we need to set up something that we can show to our customers or to our management to convince them that this can become a product. If you do a very good job, then you have the second problem, because those people will think that the product is already ready to be shipped, and then you have to develop and release it quickly, even if you don't have such a constraint. But usually development needs to be able to release quickly, because of course you want to go on the market, you want to be probably the first one going on the market with a new generation of products ahead of your competition. But still, as I mentioned before, you need to release something that needs to be reliable. And another thing that it's very relevant in embedded is that embedded devices are going to be to stay on the market for quite a long time, 10 years, even more, compared to consumer products that after 1 or 2 years are just forgotten by the company making them. Embedded devices need to be maintained in the long term. So it means that the software that you are developing today is quite likely to be used for 10 years or even more, and you need to be able to maintain this. So how can we manage this kind of complexity? Let's look at what you can do on the hardware side. On the hardware side, you can use a system of modules. Basically, by using a system of modules, you, delegate the job of dealing with high-speed interfaces to memory or other things to our hardware designers, and you are getting a module that exports very standard and relatively easy to use interfaces. So designing a carrier board for a system of modules, a system of module is not more complex than designing a carrier board or a board around the microcontroller, even if the technology we use on the system of module is much more advanced and much more complex. In the same way, you can try to work on the software side. So if you try to take some existing components and use them as building blocks for your solution, probably you have a reliable foundation for your software, and you are also going to be fast in development and be definitely more productive. When I'm talking about those building blocks, I mean that you may have some ready-to-use components. So you can take, for example, a database engine or a web server and just use it as it is. You can also have frameworks that help you developing your software, providing quite a lot of services. For example, you can have Qt, you can have .NET Core, you can have Python, and so on, Java. For those frameworks, you can also have smaller components that are usually libraries that can help you for a specific issue. So you need to implement a specific kind of communication interface or something like this. If you find a library that already implements that feature, you save quite some time. And also, it's not just the development time, not just the time you spend writing code, but it's mostly the time testing it. And if you use something that many people use, everyone is a tester, so you probably can benefit from this. And if you want to connect your device, and this is a requirement that it's becoming more and more important, to a cloud-based backend or to a server, you need to do that in a secure way. And so having clients or libraries supporting this kind of connectivity protocols and allowing you to establish this connection in a secure way without having to take care yourself by all the details is definitely, definitely useful. When we integrate different building blocks, we also have some challenges. The first one is to define some clear interfaces. We have different components, they have to talk to each other, and so we need to specify how they are supposed to be talking to each other, and we need to clearly define this so we can have even independent developers or development teams working on the different components. When we work on components, we should also consider the dependencies. When we use, for example, a complex framework like Qt or .NET or something like this, this is dragging inside our operating system and a lot of libraries and small components. So this is something we need to manage to figure out how to resolve those dependencies. And talking about separate development teams, one thing you may need to consider is release cycles. In embedded, traditionally, people used to have kind of a slow release cycle, like releasing every few months or even every year, and putting all the changes in a single release. This works for a closed device. If your device is connected, some changes and updates may need to be delivered quickly to the market. For example, if you have a web front end on your device so people can connect using a browser and vulnerability is discovered in the framework you use to implement this feature, probably you don't want to wait for 1 year before shipping some updates. You want to ship this kind of update very quickly. So I've been talking about a lot of theory until now. Let's try to apply this theory to a more realistic example. It's not a real world sample. I didn't take any project from any of our customers, but I'm trying to imagine a kind of industrial machine. And yeah, just to prove that it's really nothing too real, we call it the broccolinator. And basically the broccolinator is a machine that is going to check and wrap some vegetables with plastic and then put a label on them by weighting them and making them ready to be shipped to customers. When we start this kind of projects, we are going to have some requirements. The first one, and I think the typical one, if you're talking about an industrial device, is that it must be fast and must be reliable. We are talking about production. The difference between an industrial device and a consumer device like your phone is that you mainly use your phone to spend your money, but you want to use an industrial device to make money. And if you're making money, the faster the device, the more money you can make. That's pretty good. And also, it needs to be reliable because you cannot afford to stop your production for 1 day because one machine is stopped or needs some fixes or whatever. We want to ship this machine to different markets, so we want to make it more flexible, more configurable, so we can support different kinds of vegetables and so on. We also want, always, I think, we want to actively monitor the different supplies, so vegetables, plastic, labels, so users can be proactive. They can see that the labels are going to finish in 10 minutes, I'm going to replenish them or something like this. And we talk about connectivity. Our device needs to be connected to some kind of factory automation and information system. So we need to exchange data. And we also want to store this data maybe locally so we can have statistics, we can see what happened on the machine and so on. So we start defining kind of, let's say, process for our machine. So we are going to check our vegetables, check that it's the right thing, check that it's okay, it's not damaged. Then we need to wrap it in some protection, so some plastic. We need to weight it, and from the weight, we need to print out a label that we're going to stitch to the thing and getting ready to be sold in a supermarket or something like this. If we start to look in detail into these, let's say, procedural blocks, we start to have some questions. For each step, probably we have to think about some hardware interfaces because we need to figure out how we're going to check or what is going to move the wrapping mechanism or how we can weight those things and so on. We also have some specific question about specific blocks. For example, we want to check the vegetables. Can we do this with vision? Can we leverage machine learning to build some machine learning model that can be used to determine if one one broccoli is good or not. And we also have some more generic questions, like, for example, where and how are we going to store our data, or which format should we use for exchange those data with the systems outside. And also some functional questions, like, do we want a local user interface? Do we want a remote one? Do we want them both? That are also some questions that you may have when you start developing this kind of project. Let's move forward with our work on the broccolinator. So we should try to apply some of the, let's say, principle of modern software design we have been talking about before to this project. So we want to leverage existing components. We don't want to reinvent the wheel. That's definitely important. We also want to leverage some existing expertise in our development team. We don't want to have to retrain all the people or to have them learning completely new technologies if it's possible. But on the other side, we want also to use the right tool for the job. That means, for example, even if we have a development team that it's made of C developers, low-level C developers, we have been writing firmware until now. But if we need to implement a web-based front-end, probably there are technologies like Node.js, ASP.NET, Flask, if you use Python, that are definitely much more productive than writing C code for this purpose. And so we need to balance those two requirements. We need to leverage the experience, but we also need to choose the right tools. And if it's needed, some people need to learn something new, or maybe we need to hire some new people to do this kind of things. And yeah, in general, we want to be flexible. So during development, requirements may change. One reason can be that we have bad specifications at the beginning. That's not a good thing. But another reason can be that we are showing our new machine to customers and they are asking some new features. And this is probably something we need to handle during development. So we start, you know, with an empty page and we start drawing our building blocks. So we identify some functional blocks now. We have some external things like the factory management system or the hardware. And then we start thinking about what we need to implement. And we can identify some different components. One can be a control engine. That means something that is talking with the hardware. This is going to drive the physical part of the machine or to collect data from the sensors. Then we have a business logic that is basically integrating all the different things and make the machine operating using the flow and the process we have seen at the beginning. On top of this, we have our local UI and our remote UI. As we have seen from the poll, many people want to use them both. So, okay, we are going to implement them both. Let's move forward. And we start to shuffle around our blocks, add some other things. Okay, we need definitely to store data. So we need a database. We talk about vision and machine learning to recognize our vegetables and check if they are good or bad. This is another block. Or actually a circle. And then we also think about how all those things are going to interact together. So the business logic, as you can see, it's basically at the center. It's mostly driving all the other things or providing information for them, and so on. After this step, we also start to stitch some technologies to the different blocks and also to the connection between them. This means that we are going to decide which kind of protocols we want to use. We can have some high-level protocols like a REST API that is definitely easy to use from the client point of view. It's standardized and so on. It's not super performant if you need to transfer a lot of data or if you need quick replies. So maybe from some local interaction, like for example, talking with the control engine, we can use a socket. We can just send very simple commands. We can even use a local Unix socket, so not a network connectivity, and so on. We start deciding how those things need to communicate. We have been talking about interfaces. At this stage, we are defining basically the interfaces and also the protocols we're going to use for them. And also we stitch some ideas, some technologies to the different components. So we have a control engine. There we need to talk with the hardware. We probably need some reactivity, some performances. So probably we are going to write some native code. It can be C++, it can be C. Or we can use some existing solution. We can use a software PLC. We have solution, for example, from our partner CodeSys, and definitely it's quite a good and popular solution if you need to drive some external devices. Then we have the business logic. Here, basically, we are not doing any kind of heavy computation. We are just, it's just a kind of glue logic between the different components. So we can use some high-level languages. We don't have to care about memory allocation or native compilation. We can use C#, if you are familiar with .NET, or we can use Python. We can also use .NET or Python or even JavaScript for the remote UI. We can use ASP.NET, we can use Node.js. If you use Python, you can use Flask or other frameworks. We start to think about the local UI. There we can use, for example, Qt, that is a very popular framework. You can use it in C++ or in Python. You can use some, high-level tools to design the UI, like Crank. It's one of our partners. You can also decide that you just want to run a browser and show the remote UI locally. That can also be a solution. You can do this directly from a browser, or you can use some web-based technologies locally, like Electron or something like this. And we need a database. We need more complex data, so we can use a SQL database like, PostgreSQL, MySQL, or we want to store events tracked by time, so what usually people call time series. For this, for example, InfluxDB is a very good solution. And we need to do some image recognition. So here we can talk about OpenCV, we can talk about TensorFlow, and this involves also machine learning. So at the end of this discussion, we define what we're supposed to be doing. We have an idea of how are we going to be doing it in terms of technologies. And now we have another question: to build or not to build? The idea here is, okay, we can decide if we want to, do this in the traditional way, so building a Linux image that contains everything we need and ship it as an image, or if we want to use containers. If we want to build our images, those are the steps you're supposed to be doing. First thing, you need, of course, to get some hardware support layers. I'm saying layers because, you may use Yocto or Open Embedded. You may use also different tools like Buildroot, but let's stick to the most popular ones. Then you need to find to develop your custom components. That means the control engine, business logic, and the UIs. You also need to add to your image the frameworks and also additional components you may need, and you see the list there. Once you are done, you need to manage the dependencies, and if you use Open Embedded, that's usually done by the tools themselves. If you have recipes for your components, usually they take care of the dependencies, but it may happen that you have some conflicts. You have some things that work with Python 3.6, some things that require Python 3.8, and then you need to decide, okay, I'm going to downgrade some components so they can work with the old version, or I'm going to spend some time moving some, more old component to the latest version. It's kind of a challenge. Once you're done, definitely the main advantage is that you're going to have an optimized image. You analyze the dependencies, you find the right things, you put them in the right place, you have one instance of everything, and that's the minimum amount of storage and memory you need to run your services. On the other side, you have a big release. So basically you build the whole image. Every time you want to ship a new version, you have to build a new image. And if this happens because you need to update something, the sample we made at the beginning, you need to update your web server because there is a vulnerability. When you update the web server, maybe the fix is not in the web server itself, it's in one of the libraries it's using. And this library, it's used also by another component. And at this point, you have some shared dependencies and you need to deal with that. if I'm changing the library, something may happen in the other component. So I need probably to test everything together again to be able to ship a new version. So my release cycle probably is not as fast, as agile as I was planning. On the other side, we can use containers. And a good definition for containers in this context is that basically a container is a way to package your software. You package your software and its user mode dependencies. So basically, one of the mantra of the software industry has always been, it works on my machine. Okay, that usually means that it's not working on other machines because they have different version of something and it's not working. And basically with a container, you can ship your machine or at least user mode dependencies. And all the containers are packaged in the same way, like real world containers. So the container runtime can run, deploy any container, not caring about what it's doing specifically. Every container is the same, we use it and treat it in the same way. Another thing that's interesting from our point of view is that containers are providing a controlled and reproducible environment for your software. So you decide what you put inside the container, you pack all the dependencies, and you have full control of this. You are not forced to change anything because something else is using the same thing in a different version. You decide exactly what you want there, and you decide when you want to change something. Each functional block we identified before, it's going to be a container, it's going to have its own release cycle. As long as we clearly define the interfaces, we can update some parts of the system without touching the rest. Okay, so when we start developing using containers, we need to choose a base operating system that can run containers. If you use our modules, you are in a good position because we have such a solution that is named Torizon. Then you can start defining the containers for the different features. So again, control engine, business logic, the UIs, the vision part. And then you can also add some additional services. For example, if I need a database and I want to use InfluxDB, InfluxDB is already coming as a container, so I just need to get it and configure it so it can run with the rest of my solution. What are the advantages of this kind of approach? Basically, we have multiple independent execution environments. So each application, it's running with the right charge and control of when I'm going to change something. And this means that I can have full independent release cycles. We need to patch the web server for this security issue. Okay, we are going to patch it. Of course, we are going to test again the container. I'm not going to talk about continuous integration and testing in this webinar because the time is not too long, but this is also another important aspect of modern software development. And having a container as an execution unit helps also in this aspect because you have a well-identified, let's say, building block with clearly defined interfaces. So it's also easier to test these as a single unit. The disadvantages, of course, nothing comes for free, is that we have an increased footprint, definitely. We need more storage, we need more memory because we have some duplication. We are going to have multiple versions of the same libraries. We are going to have similar components in different containers, and this increases the footprint. And of course, from the developer point of view, you probably have to learn something new. I honestly like to learn something new, so for me it's not a disadvantage, but if you have a full development team that needs to use a new technology, definitely you need to allocate some time, so this is definitely something you need to consider. Okay, after all this discussion, okay, I still think that containers are only for hipsters. Okay, you see this old grumpy guy. I am myself an old grumpy guy, so I can use this image. And let's see some of the objections you may have against containers, mostly in embedded. The first one is that containers are usually identified as kind of virtual machines. Even in open embedded, the layer that contains Docker is named meta virtualization. And it's probably not fully correct. Meaning containers are not virtual machines. We're going to see it in the next slide, but basically we are not running multiple kernels and multiple operating system together using some kind of hardware virtualization. That's not going to happen. Definitely containers are going to require more storage. So from this point of view, they are heavier than the previous solution we have seen. But we have some technology behind the container runtime that can help us reducing this footprint. For example, container images are organized in layers. That means, for example, you start from a Linux distribution. You use, for example, Debian, and Debian is going to be the first layer. Then you add some additional packages, second layer. Then you add your application, third layer. If you have two applications using the same version of Debian, they're going to share the first layer. That means that you store this stuff only once on your system, so you save quite some storage. And also, if you load some libraries from this layer, also the memory used for the library is going to be shared. As if you load them from the same physical file on a Linux file system. So this is also helping reducing the footprint. Why I say that containers are not virtual machines? Here you can see kind of architecture diagram. We have a, let's say, standard Linux process. The process usually interacts with the file system. You know, everything is a file on Unix, and through this it talks with the Linux kernel that in turn talks to the hardware. Okay, it's the traditional stack of a Linux system. If we think about the container, we still have a process running there. The only difference is that the container has a different view of the file system. So here we have a different file system, but still we get to the kernel through the file system. So the number of layers we have is exactly the same. And in terms of overhead, a kernel call from a user mode process and the kernel mode from a process running inside the container is exactly the same. So we don't have any kind of virtualization or kind of fake hardware devices emulating the real ones or something like this. We go straight to the kernel and we run as regular processes. Yeah, that's good. So they are not virtual machines, but we still can't access the hardware. That's the default. I mean, containers are born in the cloud and server environments. And there, definitely, you don't want that something running on your server is touching your hardware. I mean, I'm using maybe different containers from different people running different applications. I don't want that the container is allowed to, like, you know, access partition table on my hard drive and crash my machine. That's not going to happen. And by default, containers are not able to access any hardware. But this is just the default. Container runtimes like Docker provide features to access devices inside the container. So you can share a device into a container, and the container can access it. And it can access it as any user mode process using a file. You know, everything is a file. Everything is a file also inside the container. If we map the file in the right place, it's working. So also for hardware access, it's not going to work by default, but you need to configure your container in the right way when you execute it, and then it's going to work. Yeah, but if we want to run a graphic UI, we are still talking about hardware. GPUs, accelerators are hardware, and they can be accessed in the same way. So you can still share them inside your container and have them running. What we do on Torizon, we provide a special container that it's the it's Weston. It's a Wayland compositor. Wayland is the, let's say, modern way to implement graphic UI on Linux. It's replacing X11 that is probably even older than me, and it's not easy. So if you use Wayland, basically you have this compositor taking ownership of the screen and the mouse and the keyboard, and then you have clients, and those clients can run in the same context or they can run in a container. In the demo, we are going to see a graphical application made using Qt running inside the container. But containers are still complicated. Yeah, every new technology is complicated. And the funny part is that we are using those technologies to manage complexity, but we are adding complex stuff to our stack. But if you look into the container implementation, it's not that complicated. As we have seen in the architecture, they are really not introducing any new layer apart from this kind of sandbox where my applications are running. And also, if you try to build a container, it's not that hard. You can write a Docker file. You can find a lot of information about this. And basically, the Docker file is a sequence of commands that you run if you want to install some software on your system. So if you are, for example, using Debian, you're going to have your own Debian-based image, and then you are going to do apt-get install, I don't know, Python or whatever, and executing multiple steps, installing packages, changing configuration files, and so on. It's the same, more or less the same kind of stuff you can do with the shell script, you can do with the Docker file. So working with these things, if you are familiar with the Linux environment, is not that complicated. And also you have a lot of pre-built containers that already integrate quite a lot of features. So you can get a container with the .NET runtime, or a container with Python, Java, or something else. And if you have something like this, you just need to integrate your application. So you need only to take care of placing your application in the right place, starting when the container is starting. That's it. And you even have some components that are already provided as containers. We have been talking about in FluxDB. We have frontends like Grafana or Chronograph. You just have a container, you just need to run it. You don't need even to look into it to figure out what's there. Of course, probably you should do this because you're shipping it as part of your solution. But I mean, to run it, you don't need to know anything specific about it. And just the last thing about this, you can also use container when you're building your software. If you try to build native software using a compiler, C++ compiler on Linux, you need the toolchain, and usually doing cross-compilation, it's quite complicated. I mean, I used to say that they say it's called cross-compilation because you work across architecture, but actually they say it's called cross-compilation because the cross is one of the worst way to torture people, you know, and that's why they use this name. But the good thing is that if you have a container, you can set up your own toolchain there, and it's going to stay as it is. You don't have to be worried about the fact that you update your machine, your main operating system, and this can make some changes to the toolchain, or you're managing 5 projects and then you update the toolchain for one and then you compile another one with different one, and you can have some unexpected behaviors. Okay, containers can be used also during development. And again, they can also be used during testing and this kind of operations. But we are still wasting a lot of resources. Okay, let's talk about this. The main point for me is that hardware is cheap and your time is expensive. I mean, I'm not saying that our modules are super cheap, but they are quite competitively priced. But even if the hardware is a bit expensive, if you are making 2 million devices, saving €1, $1, one whatever you want on the bill of material makes sense. We are multiplying this by the number of devices. But if saving this money requires that you work for weeks or months more, or you use some more complex low-level technologies to build your application, because in this way you can use a low-end module or a low-end CPU. If you are making thousands of devices or hundreds of devices, are you really saving some money? Maybe using a more powerful hardware platform and using more productive technologies to develop your application, at the end is going to be a bargain. Also, if you have something customized and heavily optimized, you are probably the only person that is able to maintain this thing. If you use existing components, maybe they don't provide exactly the same performances of some custom written super optimized code. But on the other side, you're not going to take care of the maintenance. Someone else is doing it and you just get the latest release. So you should weigh the benefits. Okay, but we talk about packages. You have been mentioning Debian. So that's the same thing as running a distro. No, actually you can run different distribution on the same machine. And that can be useful because some components that you get use a different base distribution. They don't use Debian, they use Alpine or Red Hat, whatever. And also you can have different versions of the same distribution. I have something that runs on Debian Buster and something else that needs Debian Bullseye, that is the latest one. But I don't want to move the old stuff to Bullseye because I already know that I need to update some things and something is not gonna work. Okay, I can keep running them together with two different versions, or I can use two different copies of the same version of the distribution with different libraries, different packages. Okay, this is what grants me the capability of having separate release cycles. Okay, and even you don't need a distribution to build a container. In some cases, you can build it from scratch by just putting the right files in the right places. Okay, after all of this, so basically you are saying that containers are the only way to develop embedded software? Absolutely no. As I said, I am an old developer. I started developing on embedded in 1998, 1999. It was the previous millennium. And when I started, the discussion there was about, is it worth to use an operating system on my embedded device? And at that time, most of the people were developing firmware. So they were writing everything from scratch, or anyway, working at a very low level. And they were saying, okay, why should I use an operating system? I'm going to have layers in between. I'm not going to be able to access my hardware. My user mode processes are isolated. You know, do you feel something similar to the discussion we are having nowadays about containers? They are exactly the same topics. And today, we see a lot of devices running an operating system, most of them Linux. And Linux is a technology that has been created for servers, and it moved to embedded. Okay, so 20 years after, I can see some similarities in this story. But I should say, not all devices nowadays are running a full-blown operating system. We still have plenty of devices running a firmware. And it makes sense because operating system gives some advantages in some scenarios, and in other scenarios, doesn't make sense to use them. And that's the same thing about containers. There are some scenarios where I think definitely using containers is an advantage, allow you to be more productive, more flexible. And there are other scenarios where you probably are going to run just a single container with a single application. So probably there you can still use, old school operating system, building the image with that application in. Okay, but you know, you have many things in between, so you can decide. If you know this technology, you can evaluate its usage and decide when it makes sense and when it doesn't. But definitely use containers. Okay, as I said before, if you plan to use our modules and if you want something that can run containers, we have Torizon. We are working on this. It's under development. We are close to have a release. It's reliable enough for you to start making a proof of concept, a prototype, or start developing your application. Our goal is to make you to improve your time to market, so to help you being productive. We provide a binary distribution that you can take as it is. We provide also some tools that integrate with Visual Studio and Visual Studio Code, so you can use an IDE to develop your code. We currently support C and C++, C#, and Python. And if you have other languages you would like to use, just let us know. Also, Torizon is fully open source. So if you want, you can take it, you can build it. It's based on Yocto and Open Embedded, so it's pretty a standard way to build it. If you want to use it and customize it, you can try. We also have support for over-the-air updates. So basically you can deliver updates to your devices quite easily and quite reliably. We are working on security. So we have a security advisor tool that is basically checking your system for known vulnerabilities and helping you to try to keep everything safe. We are also investigating in secure boot and this kind of features. And last thing, we also provide a version that uses the Linux kernel with preempt RT patches. Those patches are not making the kernel hard real time, that's not possible, but they are greatly reducing the latencies. So if you need to react quickly to external events, that can be a solution that you can use today. Okay, in terms of containers, we provide a Docker runtime that is pretty standard, I would say. You can find a lot of information and tutorials and examples about using Docker. And we have quite some features around this. So we provide some Debian container that you can use as base for your application. We also provide some ready-to-use container, some from our partners, and so on. Okay, I've been talking quite a lot, so let's move to the demo. I had 1 day and a half to build it, so I tried to build the prototype of our broccolinator. I use a network camera, some hardware, and to read data from a scale. I use some additional hardware. I mean, as you can see, I'm not a hardware designer manage a switch and a couple of LEDs. Most important, I use our own Xora carrier board with an Apalis IMX8 Quad Max. I also have a very fancy fan for it. And yeah, some vegetables. I also used TensorFlow to recognize images. It's really a quick demo, so it's really a basic model with some minimal training, but it works, so you can see, and maybe you can consider such a solution. We have partners that can really help you optimize this kind of machine learning image recognition implementations. Let's start the video.
Okay, let's start the demo by having a look at the hardware. Here we have a very simple small scale with a load cell. The load cell is connected to an amplifier with a kind of an SPI interface that we control using GPIOs from our Xora board with an IMX8 QM. And here we have some very simple additional hardware, just a switch to start the waiting process and a couple of LEDs to show if it succeeded or not. And this is just an off-the-shelf network camera that it's sending the image to our Qt application, showing the camera and also the results of the waiting and recognition process. Let's move to the software side. This is Portainer. Portainer is a tool that allows you to check which container are running on your system. We also provide it as part of our evaluation and demo images. As you can see here, we have 8 containers running. We have Portainer itself. We have the Qt application, that's Qt client. We have the container with the business logic that has been developed in Python using our IDE tools. We have Chronograph, that is a front end for the database. We're going to see it at the end of the presentation. We have a container where we have TensorFlow Lite model, again running as a Python application. We have Weston that is used to manage the graphic UI, the container that we use to access hardware, and InfluxDB, the database engine. And as you can see, for each container using the Portainer UI, we can see basically what's happening, see the logs and everything. Now let's try. So let's start by putting some vegetables on our scale. As you can see, just place them, push the button, and the system is going to recognize and weight our goods. Okay, that's cauliflower, that's the weight. Let's try with the broccoli, because of course we named the application Broccolinator, so should be able to recognize broccoli, and it did. You see, weight and type again. And now let's try without anything on the scale, and so our system is not able to recognize any known kind of vegetable, and it's just showing an error. And this is Chronograph, that is basically a front end that allows us to explore data inside an InfluxDB database. It's released by the same company. And here you can see we have a dashboard, so we can see over time, 12 hours in this case, the average weight of our vegetables, and also We have a list of all the events. As you can see, we should improve a bit the error messages. We also have all the measurements that we have registered. We need to stretch this a little bit, and you can see also the weight. The interesting part of this UI is, we didn't have to write any code to have it. Basically, it was just a matter of configuration. With this frontend, you can basically create queries using this panel. You can select your table, you can select your fields. You can also use a query language that is similar to SQL. It's a bit different because in FluxDB it's mainly used to store time series, and here you can see you can also have a graphical view. So you can build this kind of dashboard basically with no programming at all.
Okay, so as you have seen, the demo was from a recorded video, but yeah, we have proof that it was working.
Before we get into the questions, we have a quick poll for you. After this presentation, we would like to understand if this presentation was good to convince you, at least trying containers or thinking about containers for your new project, or if you still think that they are just for hipsters. Okay, I'm going to give you 20 seconds more to answer to the poll. And in the meantime, if you have questions, you can use the question panel to answer them. Okay, let's see the results. Yeah, at least no one thinks that they are just for hipsters. I can understand that they, as I said during the presentation, they may not fit every scenario, but it's interesting that the majority of the people are thinking about using or at least evaluating them for the new projects. Okay, we can move to the Q&A part. We have some questions we got via email before this webinar. Are you supporting only Debian-based container? In the presentation, I mentioned Debian multiple times, and definitely Debian it's what we support directly. We provide some Debian-based containers that remap the users we have in Torizon into the container. That makes sharing things between containers and OS easier. We also provide Debian-based containers with different features like a kiosk mode browser or the graphical UI server Western and so on. But that does not mean that you can only run Debian containers there. We suggest to use Debian because it's easy to use. It provides a wide range of features, but you may use different distribution. Now, we actually did also in the demo because the FluxDB container, for example, is not based on Debian. You can use Alpine if you want to minimize the size of your containers, or if you're used to use different distribution like, I don't know, Red Hat, something like this, you can use them to build your containers. It's really not a problem. You probably need to do a bit more work because we already fixed some issues with Debian, so you need to do the same with other distribution, but we are here to help. So if you need that, you can probably contact our technical support. How can I reduce the size of my containers? If you use Debian, we use, for example, the Debian Slim version of the distribution that is really designed for containers. It's not containing, sorry for the duplication, it's not containing all the things you usually need, for example, to start up a full-blown system like server daemons or something like this. And this already has quite a lot in shrinking down the size. We also try to minimize dependencies. We don't install required and suggested packages by default. Of course, this may require a bit more effort when you need to figure out which packages you need to run your specific application. But on the other side, you can really save quite some space by doing this work. We are also doing some experiments about minimizing the size of further updates of your containers. There is a repo on our GitHub page. If you search on GitHub/Toradex, it's called Docker Image Tool, and it's just an open source tool. It's really kind of an experiment, so we don't put any warranty in it, but it's something you may try. Another thing you can use is to use Alpine that it's a very small distribution designed for containers. We decided to not use Alpine because Alpine is based on Mosel C, that it's a version of the C library that is less popular than glib, and also it's not providing all the features. So you may discover that some features are not there, or that using your software on top of this library requires some effort. How can I prevent an application running inside a container from damaging other application or the operating system itself? By default, as I say, containers are really sandboxed. And so in theory, unless you leverage some kernel bugs, your application shouldn't be able to do much damage. It's not even accessing directly the file system. Of course, you may need to share some additional things, folders from the host OS, or services or sockets or something like that. And of course, the more things you share, the more you increase the risk of potential issues. But it's going to be the same as having a process running. So I would say, worst case, you end up with a regular process running on top of the kernel. It's already quite safe. So yeah, it's really depending. You should be careful again, as I said before, with the packages. It takes a bit of effort, but you should just be sure that you are sharing the minimum set of things inside the container to let it run, not just share everything, okay, it works, and then move forward. How can I build containers for ARM models on an x64 PC server? This happens quite often when you're developing or if you want to integrate container builds in your CI/CD pipelines. Actually, you can easily do this if you use a Windows machine or a Mac. Docker Desktop provides this feature by default. If you use Linux, you can still do this. You can use QEMU and bin format and basically enable ARM emulation. Of course, running the containers in emulation is not a good idea. You lose a lot of performances, but using emulation to build them is not that bad because actually QEMU emulate the user mode. So as soon as you make requests to the kernel, it's quite performant. And most of the time building stuff in containers means downloading packages, installing them, so shuffling files around. And even in emulation, this is not that bad. Another thing you can do if you have an ARM64 machine, you can also run ARM32 containers. If you can, I suggest to build for ARM64 natively, but if it's not possible, this can be an option. A container could persist data. I mean, could I analyze a container that was running in a specific module, just transferring a container to be analyzed? I mean, usually if you want to have persistent storage, it shouldn't be inside the container. You can map a folder from your host system inside the container and use it to store permanent data, or you can use Docker volumes that are pretty much the same thing. It's just Docker creating the folder in its own location. In this way, you can keep permanent data separated. But if for whatever reason you want to kind of take a snapshot of the container, you can do this. You can commit the container. So basically, you generate a new image that is the base image of the container plus an additional layer with all the changes that the software made inside the container file system. So you can take this kind of snapshot. Of course, I don't suggest to use this method to install your software or something like this, because if you take a snapshot, yeah, it works, but the issue is that you don't know exactly what you have been doing and it's not reproducible. If you want to build containers, you can write a Docker file that is basically a script with all the steps you do to create your container. What are the licensing models for OTA and device tree overlay functionality? Device tree overlay, it's supported by default in Torizon, so it's not connected to a license. We have support for OTA. Honestly, I'm not a commercial person, so I don't know exactly. I know that there is a free tier with some functionality, and if you need more functionality, then we have a plan, so you pay. I think it's for device. But honestly, for this, probably the best thing is that if you reach out to sales in your location, they for sure can provide you more information about this. Okay, I don't see any other question. So If you have a question, you have 30 seconds to finish writing it. How hard is to run Qt in a container with Wayland? We have some samples about this. You can run a container with Weston, that it's kind of it's the compositor for Wayland. It's, let's say, if you use the old X11 concept, it's kind of the X server. And then you can run your application and they can talk over a socket. That's the, let's say, basic model. If you need to use like 3D acceleration or something like this, you can do this. You need to give access to your application container to a bit more things inside the host machine. But for example, we have been able to run the kinematic demo from Qt. That is quite a famous demo, the one with all the movies that you can scroll with some nice effects. And the frame rate is the same as you run it on top of the regular system. Just go on our website, you'll find some example. Also, if you use our IDE integration, you can use the Visual Studio Code integration extension, sorry. And with this one, you can develop Qt application using C++ or Python. This can give you an idea of how you can run it. But definitely, it's doable. We have it documented. Okay, if there are no more last second questions, we can. And thank you anyway for all the questions. Okay, I think we can close it. Thank you very much for your time and see you in the next webinar. Bye.